हेलो।
यू आर ऑडिबल सर।
यू आर ऑडिबल।
यस,
थैंक यू।
थैंक यू। सो एट द आउटसेट आई थैंक पी करुणानिधि, वाइस प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ अलेम्बिक फार्मास्यूटिकल्स, फॉर इंट्रोड्यूसिंग मी to the audience. I am also thankful to Dr. Santosh Shinde, who is the Assistant General Manager of Alembic Pharma, Mr. R.K. Sharma, AGM, Dr. Naresh Kulkarni, Dr. Sanjay Latkar, Dr. Amit Singh, who are working as a Group Product Manager for Alembic Pharmaceuticals, Dr. Gangadhar Thumre, who is working as assistant product manager, and Mr. Prem Kumar, who is now accompanying me, who is acting as a field sales officer from Latur. Really, I feel very happy that Alembic Pharmaceuticals has organized a very good activity in the form of webinar for our veterinarians, which includes the field veterinarians from all over the country, academic staff members, as well as the student fraternity. We are whole world, including India, is passing through a very critical period. And there are so many challenges which we are facing. Our veterinary faculty and veterinarians, they are also facing so many challenges during this COVID-19 outbreak. No doubt the revenue officers, the police officials, all the administrators, they are working hard to meet the challenges faced by the public. But I feel very proud that veterinarians from all over the country, they are also working as a corona warriors, and they are helping the dumb animals and poor farmers. They are providing health services to the doorstep of the farmers. They are tackling the emergency cases of the farmers, although they are having risks to their life. Now the veterinarians, definitely, they will have to take their own care even while giving service to the farmers. We'll have to use PPEs wherever mask is required, goggle, aprons, etc. And I know that many of the veterinarians, they are taking their own care and also taking care of the animals and the farmers from their region. During this COVID outbreak, no doubt veterinarians, they are serving the society, serving the farmers, but definitely the workload has gone down and we people are getting some leisure time. And the Alembic Pharmaceuticals has organized such a webinar during this period to care of this leisure period in updating the knowledge of veterinarians from all over the country. Mr. Karunanithi has introduced me lot, Dr. Santosh Shinde, who is alumni of Kwas Udgir, and my favorite student, Dr. Naresh, is also there. Definitely they have organized a very good activity and they have given me opportunity to share my actual clinical experience with all of you. At the beginning only, I would like to say that I'm just sharing my personal experience. You people also can add, share your views at the end of my lecture. The topic which has been given to me, that is diagnostic and therapeutic modalities for the metabolic disorders in the dairy animals. Metabolic diseases, you all know that the metabolic diseases, they have become an emerging problem, particularly in high producing dairy animals all over the world. With the introduction of artificial insemination program in our indigenous cattle and grading up program in case of the buffaloes, the high-yielding buffaloes and high-yielding crossbred animals, they are being reared by the farmers. And these high-yielding animals, they are more prone to the metabolic diseases due to imbalance between the rate of input nutrients and output in terms of milk production. These diseases are gotten from economic point of view because few of the diseases, they are causing mortality in dairy animals, but mainly these diseases, they are causing drop in milk production or reduced milk production. Apart from this, these metabolic diseases, they are responsible for suboptimal or poor reproductive performance. You all know that milk fever, ketosis, and hypomagnesemia, they are considered as important metabolic disorders in the dairy cows all over the world. But in Indian scenario, in my opinion, and as far as the reports from field veterinarians and even the research reports from all over the country, the phosphorus-related metabolic disorders are most common. Those are followed by milk fever and ketosis. So we'll discuss these diseases one by one. So milk fever is also known as the parturient paresis, occurring in case of high-yielding dairy animals during or around the time of the parturation. This particular milk fever is a sporadic type of a metabolic disorder, but on certain farm, the incidence may go up to 5 to 7%. But the most important is the subclinical hypocalcemia, which is very common in a multiparous cows at the time of calving or during the early lactation. And the incidence of subclinical hypocalcemia on certain dairy farm has been reported around 66%. Milk fever is also economically important disease, and the affected animal may die if not treated in time. But apart from this, the milk fever increases the risk of dystocia, retention of placenta, metritis, prolapse of uterus and abomasal displacement in the recently cowed animal by threefold. Even it increases the risk of ketosis and mastitis by ninefold. The animals suffering from milk fever, they show the incoordination in the gait, even while gatting up also, during the recovery also, and they may fall down and may suffer from a musculoskeletal injuries like fracture and dislocation. Recumbent animals, they develop bloat and regurgitation may occur that may lead to aspiration pneumonia. Milk fever is caused by hypocalcemia, and this hypocalcemia may be due to animal or dietary risk factors. Since long, we are giving importance to the animal risk factors, particularly the excess drain of calcium through the milk or cholesterol. through every kg of milk produced, 2.3 gram of the calcium is being drained, and through every kg of the milk produced, 1.2 gram of the calcium is drained. Actually, the calcium pool in the body is a very small, and it is just around 4 to 4.5 gram. And all of a sudden, animal is draining a large amount of calcium through the colostrum or through the milk. So this excess drain of calcium accompanied by slow mobilization of calcium from the bone may result into the milk fever. So milk fever usually occurs due to excess drain of calcium through colostrum beyond the capacity of the body to mobilize the calcium from the bone or the skeleton. In addition, decreased absorption of calcium from gastrointestinal tract at the time of parturition may be due to some digestive disturbance, may be due to starvation, inappetence, improper calcium phosphorus ratio, or deficiency of vitamin D. So among the different factors, even the deficiency of vitamin D plays a very important role in precipitating the cases of milk fever. Calcium phosphorus ratio is also very important. Normal ratio, everybody knows it is 2:1. But the normal normal diet of our ruminant is chiefly composed of roughages. And these roughages, they are having a very wide calcium phosphorus ratio. And in our study, we could record the ratio as wide as 21:1. Apart from these animal risk factors, the dietary risk factors are also important. We consider milk fever as a disease characterized by hypocalcemia and caused by calcium deficiency. But studies have indicated that excess in calcium intake is resulting into the hypocalcemia. Particularly if the calcium intake is very high during the advanced pregnancy. In that case, the parathyroid gland will remain inactive and the mobilization of calcium at the time of parturition will not occur rapidly. High levels of phosphorus in the diet can also contribute to the milk fever. But in my opinion, this is not an important factor as far as feeding practices of our animals are concerned. Prepartum diet, recently this particular dietary factor has been given importance. There's a prepartum diet high in cations, such as sodium and potassium, and deficient in anions, that is chloride and sulfates. In Indian soils, the potassium is high, and therefore, the natural diet of ruminant, that is roughages, which are usually rich in potassium. So high potassium diet can contribute to the decreased absorption or assimilation of calcium from the GI tract. Now, how can we diagnose the cases of milk fever under the field conditions, and how can we confirm? Most of the experienced vets from all over the country, they have joined this webinar, and they might have diagnosed and treated the large number of cases. And generally, we consider history of parturition as well as the milk yield, in the high milk yield as a criteria for diagnosis of milk fever. This milk fever particularly occurs at the three stages of lactation. 3% cases, they occur just before calving, just few days before calving, maybe 4 days, 5 days, 8 days before calving. 6% cases which are occurring during the process of parturition, whereas 91% cases, they are occurring during postpartum period, that's the postpartum stage. After calving, when we discuss the distribution of cases which are occurring during the postpartum period, 75% of the cases, they are occurring within 24 hours. Means out of every four cases, one case is occurring during first 24 hours, within first 24 hours of parturition. 12% cases, they are occurring between 24 to 48 hours, whereas 4% cases, they are occurring after 48 hours. In general, the danger period or the risk period for the milk fever is 1 week before calving to 1 week after calving. But we have recorded even few cases, rare cases during advanced pregnancy and even during the late stages of lactation, where some precipitating factors, predisposing factors, they were responsible for hypocalcemia. The clinical signs are very typical, and one can very well diagnose milk fever based on the clinical signs. Such as usually the clinical signs are divided into three stages. First stage, or the stage of excitement. Here the animal is standing and shows some signs of excitement and maybe incoordination. This is a very transient stage. It lasts for a very short period, and therefore it goes unnoticed, and the cases are usually not detected during this stage. Second stage, that is a characteristic stage, which is characterized by the sternal recumbency. And during this stage, animal develops a subnormal body temperature with cold skin and extremities. Muzzle is dry. The process of defecation and urination, usually the act of they're absent. Animal may develop even bloat. So here you can very well see the sternal recumbency in a cow. This is an indigenous cow. Actually, this is a local cow. Animal, during the third stage, animal remains in the lying down condition or in a lateral recumbency. And during this stage, the body temperature becomes very much subnormal. It is very difficult to raise the vent, and animal appears as if it is dying, that is in a comatose state. No defecation, no urination, no rumination. So these are the three stages of milk fever. In laboratory, the milk fever can be confirmed by estimation of a serum calcium level. And usually low serum calcium level is a characteristic. Normal calcium level is 8 to 12 milligram. And in milk fever cases, the calcium level goes down. And again, depending upon the stage, you can find the decrease in the calcium level. In the third stage, usually the calcium level is around 4.5 or 5. But being an emergency case, we'll have to tackle it immediately. I will have to give the treatment immediately. We cannot wait. And the basic biochemical defect in case of the milk fever is a hypocalcemia. And so we'll have to correct hypocalcemia by giving calcium preparations. Actually, this calcium borogluconate is the drug of choice, which is being used all over the world for the last several years. This is a 25% preparation. As far as the dose is concerned, there is no set dose. Actually, the dose varies depending upon the severity and from case to case. But usually 400 to 800 ml of 25% calcium borogluconate is being administered for the management of milk fever. In other words, the dose is 1 ml per kg body weight that can be given, or 1 gram of calcium per 45 kg body weight. Actually, calcium borogluconate 25% contains 1.86% calcium. And so the 100 ml of calcium is sufficient for animal weighing 90 kg. So like that, we can give the dose of calcium. And depending upon the response to the treatment, we can even increase the dose. The treatment during first stage is the ideal situation. If we treat the case during first stage, then the recovery is very fast, and recovery is usually 100%. Again, in the nursing or care of this affected animal is very important. Otherwise, this milk fever may result or may turn into the Downer cow syndrome. And therefore, the animal suffering from milk fever should get a soft bedding and after treatment, animal will make attempt to get up. At that time, there are likely chances of sleeping. So animal should be kept on a floor which is having good footing. The physiotherapy, massage, and fomentation of limb muscle is advocated in a recumbent animals. Changing the sides of animal, that really helps. While getting up, the animal will not fall down or slip. Keep the animal in a sternal recumbency to prevent bloat, because bloat and even sometimes the regurgitation may occur, and that may lead to aspiration pneumonia. After giving treatment, we should not force animal to get up quickly. After giving treatment, massage of the legs should be done, and animal should be allowed to get up slowly, and we should extend help to the animal so as to prevent the calving accidents. The milk fever cases, they respond very nicely, and the symptoms of response, signs of response to the treatment include the irritation, then the muzzle will become moist, the salivation will start. The recumbent animal, even in a sitting position, may pass feces. When it's standing, may start urinating. Then there is increase in the intensity of the heart sounds. Overall, 60% of the cases, they stand immediately after treatment. They respond very nicely. 15% of the cases, which are again uncomplicated, they respond to the treatment within 2 hours of the treatment. So overall, 75% cases, they recover within 2 hours. 10% cases, they may take 6 to 8 hours. They are complicated, but they recover. But 15% cases, they either die or require disposal because of a Downer Crouch syndrome. So this is the case which we have treated in our clinic, local breed, Rathwadi breed. One of the problem faced by the field veterinarian is a relapse or poor response to the treatment. In 25% cases, the relapse of milk fever may occur, and the causes of relapse, they include delay in treatment. The case is treated in third stage. Underdosing of the calcium. The old animals, they respond poorly, or there are chances of recurrence also. If the hypocalcemia is accompanied by hypophosphatemia and hypomagnesemia, and that the animal will show the recurrence. Vitamin D deficiency also contributes to the relapse or the reoccurrence of the milk fever. So such cases always pose challenge, and they are critical, and therefore these cases need treatment. So how can we increase the success rate in a milk fever cases? We'll have to give treatment promptly, that in early stage, give proper doses of calcium. So now we have discussed, it is better to go for a compound preparations of the calcium. That is calcium, phosphorus with magnesium, that is more beneficial. So give first bottle of calcium borogluconate and second bottle of compound calcium preparation containing calcium, phosphorus and magnesium, that is always better. That will take care of a concurrent hypophosphatemia and concurrent hypomagnesemia also. That is beneficial. And if we give injection vitamin D3 along with this by intramuscular route, we can prevent relapse of the milk fever to the great extent. Calcium is considered as a cardiotoxic, and sometimes the animals may show the untoward reaction, may die sometimes, showing adverse reaction to the calcium. I have classified the factors into two groups, human factors and animal factors. Human factors include overdosing of the calcium, rapid administration of calcium. Sometimes we are in a very hurry and we give calcium very rapidly. Third is the repeated administration. Our diagnosis may not be correct and we are giving calcium repeatedly. These are the reasons for calcium toxicity. As regards the animal factors, the toxemia. Toxemia may be due to indigestion or toxemia may be due to any reason. That results into the toxicity. Again, excessive excitement. Some animals, they get excited when we give or when we start administering the calcium preparation. The symptoms, they include the tachycardia, dyspnea, trembling, collapse, and death. In some animals, while giving calcium, they collapse and die. How can we treat the calcium toxicity? Under field conditions, atropine sulfate is the best, and just 15 to 20 ml of atropine sulfate can be given by intravenous route, and that is a very good antidote for a calcium toxicity. If we use the calcium magnesium phosphorus preparation, then usually there is no toxicity because magnesium is antidote for a calcium. As regards the control measures, cold stress is found to be a predisposing factor, so protect animal from a cold stress. Exercise always increases the bone metabolism, promotes bone metabolism as well as GI function, and therefore giving exercise to the advanced pregnant animals, that is very important. Avoid long distance transportation. Generally, animals, they are being transported during the advanced pregnancy for animal markets to the animal markets, and that is found to be one of the reason for hypocalcemia during advanced pregnancy. Vitamin D3 injections are very much useful, and they provide 80% protection. Vitamin D3 can be given at the rate of 10 million units or 20,000 international units per kg weight, or 10 million units per 450 kg body weight. So in general, 10 to 15 ml of injection erythritol can be given to an advanced pregnant animal. It's 1 week before calf. That is a very good protective or prophylactic nature. Calcium is being rampantly used under field conditions immediately after calving. The dose of calcium is very important when we are giving it for prophylactic purpose. Many times, high doses of calcium, they are being given to the recently calved animals, and I have come across with hypogalaxia. Actually, we are giving calcium for increasing the milk yield, but we have come across with the cases of hypogalaxia following administration of calcium, probably due to change in the calcium phosphorus ratio in the body. And therefore, the ARD system of fixation of the dose should be used. That is appetite, ruminal motility, defecation system. So in this case, when the everything is normal, the calcium borogluconate required is just 110 ml. If there is slight reduction in the appetite, we can go for 225 ml. And if suppose the appetite, ruminal motility, and defecation, if they are adversely affected, in that case, we should go for 330 ml of calcium. Alternative to this intravenous preparation is a parenteral injection of diketonic calcium preparation. That's a Caldi-12 or any or Sencalvit or any calcium preparation, diketonic calcium preparation, which is available in the market, can be very well used, which contains diketonic calcium plus vitamin D3. And these the injections of those diketonic calcium preparations can be given at the dose rate of 15 ml intramuscularly, maybe at an interval of 2 days, 3 injections in 1 week. Third alternative for this is oral calcium preparation. So we can give calcium gel. So calcium gel, that is also very effective. Generally 40 to 45 gram of ionic calcium gel in the form of gel can be given 6 hours before calving and even 6 to 12 hours after calving. That is beneficial in prevention of milk fever. The latest strain for prevention of hypocalcemia is the managing the DCAB or a DCAD balance. Regulate the dietary cation and anion balance. The incidence of milk fever depends upon the abundance of cations, that is the positive charge, sodium and potassium. So the dietary cation anion balance includes the cations like sodium, potassium, and anions like chloride and sulfates. So if the diet is rich in the sodium and potassium. So there is some disturbance. So I was talking about the latest strain for prevention of hypocalcemia in case of the milk fever. So the incidence of milk fever depends upon the abundance of cations. If the diet is rich in sodium and potassium, the incidence of milk fever is likely to increase. And therefore, we have to manage this balance. But in my opinion, theoretically speaking, it is very easy. But practically, it is very difficult to manage this dietary cation anion balance. But for a you can say the short span during the advanced pregnancy or around the time of calving, that is the danger period, we can provide the anionic supplements to the animals, and we can manage this balance. So this is all about the milk fever. We're running short of time, and so I will have to go somewhat hurriedly. So second important disease which is occurring in our country, that is the ketosis. This ketosis is very common in adult dairy cows and buffaloes during early lactation, that in high-yielding animals. Again, clinical ketosis is a sporadic disease, but where the management is poor, feeding is improper, the incidence may go up to 6%, and the incidence of subclinical mastitis may go up to 50%. This disease is economically important. We know that ketosis is not a life-threatening disease. Very rarely, ketosis causes a case fatality. But ketosis, among all metabolic disorder, ketosis affects milk production rampantly and causes drop in milk production by 25 to 100%. Ketosis also increases the risk of retained placenta by 1.8 times, abomasal displacement by 2 to 4 times, mastitis by 2 times, and sometimes we'll have to cull the cases of ketosis, non-responsive cases of ketosis, which are not gaining the weight. So that is another, you can say, the economic loss. Apart from that, due to negative energy balance, there is a delay in postpartum estrus, and reduced conception rates, they have also been recorded. So in nutshell, ketosis not only affects the productive performance of animal, but it also adversely affects the reproductive performance of high-yielding dairy animals. Ketosis is considered as a multifactorial metabolic disorder due to energy disturbances in the energy metabolism. It is a result of negative energy balance, which is due to feeding of low carbohydrate diet. This is the main cause of ketosis in our country. So feeding of low carbohydrate diet leads to decreased propionate and hypoglycemia. The second cause, which is rare somewhat, overfeeding of protein-rich concentrate, because malnutrition is the biggest problem in our country. But on some farms, some farmers, if they are giving a protein-rich concentrate, like maybe a cotton seed, or a cotton seed cake in a very high, large quantity, unbalanced type of the diet, that may also lead to more production of butyrate, ketogenic acids, and ketosis. Excess feeding of silage is considered one of the important cause of ketosis in countries abroad. But nowadays, even silage making has been encouraged, and many of the farmers, they are preparing silage. So in near future, excess feeding of silage may lead to ketosis even in our country. So silage contains 2 to 4% butyrate, and you know butyrate is a ketogenic in nature. The most important factor why this is common in high-yielding animals, because milk contains lactose, and you all know that if through every kg of milk, 45 grams of lactose is being drunk. If a cow is producing 20 kg of the milk, that means she is losing nearly 1 kg of lactose every day. Such a huge amount of, you see, the glucose is being lost from the body, and therefore the negative energy balance develop if proper inputs, nutritional inputs are not given. Deficiency of phosphorus and cobalt may contribute to the, again, this particular ketosis. Lack of exercise, cold climate, that are the predisposing factors. Ketosis is also common in certain families, particularly having the yielding more and having less feed capacity. Hormonal factors, particularly stress factors, may lead to, you can say, the insufficiency, hypothyroidism, even insulin deficiency can also lead to ketosis. Secondary ketosis develops due to anorexia caused by any infectious disease or a systemic disease. But under field conditions, very frequently in buffaloes, we have noticed Sera in buffaloes is responsible for ketosis and theileriosis and or anaplasmosis. They are responsible for secondary ketosis in most of the crossbred animals, which when they occur during the early lactation. Ketosis can be diagnosed based on the history of a recent calving. Particular ketosis occurs 2 to 8 weeks after calving. It coincides with the peak milk yield. It is common in high yielding animals. You will get history of low plane of nutrition, low carbohydrate diet, no concentrates they are being supplemented, or overfeeding of a protein rich concentrates like cottonseed cake. And if the animals, they are not being provided with a good shelter and they are exposed to the cold climate. The typical symptom, actually the ketosis occurs in two different forms, that is the vesting form and another is the nervous form. Vesting form is the most common. 90% cases, they fall in this category. Only 10% of the cases, they fall, they show the nervous form of the ketosis. So that is somewhat rare. So in vesting form of the ketosis, the selective appetite, it is a characteristic symptom. That is a refusal of concentrate. Animal continues to eat dry leafages and greens, but refuses concentrates. This is somewhat unusual. Drop in milk production is the another sign. There is a rapid drop in milk yield. Within 2 or 3 days, there is a drastic fall in the milk yield. There is a drastic decrease in the body weight, rapid decline in the body weight within 3 or 4 days. There is a sweetish smell to the breath. So these are the typical symptoms. Wherever this cow site test facility is available, we can use Rothfuss test. It's a very good cow site test and that can be used on a farm. And even in the dispensaries for detection of subclinical mastitis as well as the clinical subclinical ketosis as well as clinical ketosis. Plasma samples can be subjected to glucose estimation and hypoglycemia is a characteristic feature of ketosis. A good response to the glucose therapy is considered as a very important criteria for confirmative diagnosis under the field conditions. Now, how to manage the ketosis? In ketosis, usually there is a hypoglycemia. So we'll have to correct it. We'll have to reduce the need of glucose and further we'll have to allow the ketone body utilization in the body. And this can be achieved by giving glucose by parenteral route. So replacement therapy with glucose 20%, 25%, 40%, 50%. Hypertonic glucose solutions, they are being recommended at the rate of 0.5 gram per kg intravenously for 2 to 3 days. So for buffalo weighing 450 kg, needs 225 gram of glucose and that needs to be supplied through the hypertonic glucose solution. Response is transient. Repeated treatments are required, usually 3 treatments, minimum 2 and maximum 3 doses of glucose therapy are required. This is the therapy which can be used in the initial stage and this is effective in more than 80% cases. The cases which doesn't respond to this therapy, we can go for a glucocorticoid therapy along with glucose therapy. So that combination can be used. Any corticoid can be used. Dexamethasone can also, dexamethasone, triamcinolone, cefepime, any steroid can be, corticosteroid can be used. And usually 2 to 3 doses of glucocorticoids and 2 to 3 doses of hypertonic glucose, they are recommended. Like anabolic steroids that have been used, but there is a ban for use of these anabolic steroids and therefore we don't recommend. Third alternative, that is insulin therapy. Insulin therapy is to be tried in unresponsive cases or the cases which doesn't give response to glucose alone, either glucose alone or glucose plus corticosteroid therapy. Here, we'll have to go for a combination of glucose and insulin therapy. So we can purchase any insulin which is being used in human beings. It is available maybe in a 10 ml vial. Each ml usually contains 40 international units. And dose is 0.5 international unit per kg body. Intramuscular as well as the subcutaneous preparations are available in the market. So those can be used. But initially, first you have to give glucose by intramuscular and then you have to give insulin by intramuscular subcutaneous. Usually one or two doses of glucose and insulin therapy are sufficient. So this is a very good therapy which can be tried in a non-responsive type of the cases. How can we prevent then ketosis? Before that, just glucogenic precursors, they are available in the market. Many of the firms, they have come up with the glucogenic precursors fortified with nicotinamide. These preparations can be used, but I'm of the opinion that they can be used as an adjunct therapy in a clinical cases or a follow-up therapy for in a clinical cases. Best way, these preparations can be very well used in case of subclinical ketosis or for prevention of ketosis. Along with the glucose therapy, B-complex with liver extract should be given, and even mineral mixture should be advised on a regular basis to take care of this phosphorus cobalt deficiency. The prevention of ketosis, cow should be neither thin nor fat at the time of calf. So feeding during advanced pregnancy is very much important. If cow is too fat at the time of calving, she is likely to suffer from ketosis. That's a fatty cow syndrome, which may occur within the first 2 weeks of calving. And if cow is very thin, then she is likely to suffer from a ketosis after 2 weeks of calving. So cow should have an optimum body condition, and the feeding should be such that during the advanced pregnancy. We should provide good quality roughages so that the feed intake animal should get optimum energy through the diet. Extra allowance of concentrate is recommended. Some owners, they are giving the concentrates which are very rich in protein. No doubt, when we give concentrate rich in protein, milk yield is increased. But ultimate result after 3 to 4 weeks is ketosis. So in high-yielding animals, some animal owners, even some farmers, progressive farmers, they are giving 1 kg of plain maize to their animal in addition to the concentrate. Ground maize is the ideal energy supplement, feed supplement for milch animals. Ground maize contains alpha polymerized glucose, and which is considered as a bypass starch or a bypass energy. And therefore, feeding of ground maize is recommended. Finely ground roughage and cooked grains. Cooked grains, when they are beneficial, propionate production is more when we give cooked grains. And this is a traditional practice in the villages, that after calving, cooked grains, they are being given to the animals. So the cottonseed and soybean, they are very good sources of not only proteins, but they are very good source of energy also. They contain a natural bypass fat. That is another or additional advantage. So in high-yielding animals, if you give the cottonseed or soybean, their energy requirement, particularly during a peak milk yield, can be met. Mineral and vitamin mixture should be given on a regular basis. So feeding of fats, the oils, they can be given. The oils were being used, but they are unpalatable. They are non-protected fat. They disturb the ruminal microflora, and therefore they are not recommended. Now many firms, they have come up with the bypass fat, fractionated fat. They are highly palatable. They are 100% rumen bypass. The main advantage that they doesn't disturb the ruminal microflora, and therefore they doesn't affect the appetite adverse. So that is the advantage over the plain oils. So the such type of the bypass fat can be given to the yielding animals during the peak lactational period. Some animals, they are more prone to the ketosis because their feed capacity is very less. They produce more, but their feeding capacity, body capacity is very less. So in those animals, we'll have to encourage the feed intake by giving a palatable type of food, a quality type of the feed and fodder at a frequent interval so that their intake can be increased. Avoid sudden changes in the diet or overfeeding, which is likely to result into indigestion and a ketosis. Adequate exercise will help in utilization of ketone bodies. Digestive functions will be proper, and definitely it will help in prevention of ketosis. Protection from inclement weather or cold stress, that is important. Selection of cows having a good feed capacity or appetite. Some cows, they are yielding very high, but their feed capacity, natural feed capacity is very low, and therefore they are much prone to the ketosis. They frequently get, they suffer from the ketosis. Such cows should be removed from the herd. They should be culled. Glucose precursors in the problem herds can be given, particularly during the peak lactational period. Rothera's test can be used as a screening test or a bedside test on heart basis. It can be performed in the particularly during the early lactation. Now, the third metabolic disease, which is, in my opinion, very common in our country, which is very widespread, that is postpartum hemoglobinuria. This particular disease is less common, particularly in advanced countries. There are reports, no doubt, of this particular disease, but those were particularly in the cows. But in India, as well as the Southeast countries, like Bangladesh and Pakistan, Egypt, so this phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria or postpartum hemoglobinuria is very common. So this disease occurs in cattle, both cattle and buffaloes, but buffaloes, they are very much prone. They are highly susceptible to cattle. In my opinion, buffaloes, they are 10 times more susceptible or prone to this particular disease as compared to cattle. That is our observation. In cows, the disease occurs during the postpartum period, that is 2 to 4 weeks after calving. 2 to 4 weeks after calving, and therefore it is called as a PPH. We have also recorded few cases of this phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria in crossbred animals during advanced pregnancy, but that is very rare. In buffaloes, the disease occurs at all stages of lactation and at all stages of pregnancy. That is our observation. But 75% of the cases which are occurring in pregnant animals, they have been recorded during advanced pregnancy, whereas 75% of the cases which are occurring during lactation, they were found during early lactation. The disease is economically very important. If the case is not treated, then it is bound to die. In treated animals, the recovery period or convalescent period is very long. The milk production, usually it goes down and it cannot be regained during that lactation. If the disease occurs during advanced pregnancy, the abortions are likely to occur. In a recently caught again animals, the postpartum estrus is delayed. The results of research conducted at Kohasuthi indicates overall incidence of 0.7% in our local very low yielding buffaloes. Season wise incidence indicated incidence throughout the year, but the incidence was found to be more during winter and summer. In some areas it is more during summer, during winter, because it's a hill area. But here I would like to make it very clear that incidence of hemoglobinuria is more common during dry season. During wet season, when the greens are available, the incidence is negligible. The physiological status-wise incidence indicates the occurrence of disease in both lactating as well as pregnant animals. 76% of the cases they were recorded in the lactating animals, whereas 23% cases they were recorded during the pregnant animals. In some areas, the more number of cases they were recorded during advanced pregnancy. Actually, it is related to the season and related to the feeding status of the egg. Stage of lactation wise incidence indicated occurrence of the disease during 2 to 4 weeks after parturition. Although here it is mentioned as 0 to 1 month, I have rarely seen case within 15 days after calf. So 65% of the cases, they were recorded during 2 to 4 weeks after calf. During second month, the number of cases, they decrease, whereas the after 2 months, the cases are very rare. High yielding animals, they are more prone. Even in our area, the buffaloes which are yielding more than 4 liters, they were found to be affected. In my opinion, season is not a much important factor. The feeding pattern is very important. The diet factor is very important. The animals which were exclusively maintained on the dry fodder, they were found to be affected. The buffaloes which were getting only dry fodder with a very meager quantity of concentrate were found to be affected. Therefore, buffaloes which were receiving green fodder and concentrate above 1 or 2 kg, they were found to be least affected. So this particular observation clearly indicate that feeding of dry roughages is a risk factor for PPH. As far as the etiology of this PPH is concerned, the deficiency of phosphorus in the diet is the main cause of phosphorus deficiency, hemoglobinuria. Forages grown on phosphorus deficient soil, that is the forages
I think there is some technical issue as such, you know, please be online. We'll be reconnecting him, Dr. Bikane sir. Please be online.
Share screen. Location get it. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Is it visible, sir?
Now it is visible, sir. Yes.
So we were discussing about the etiology of phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria. The phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria is characterized by hypophosphatemia and caused by three important factors, that is deficiency of the phosphorus in the diet, impaired absorption of phosphorus from the gut, and increased requirement of the phosphorus for production of the milk. So these are the three important factors. So as far as the dietary deficiency is concerned, the forages grown on phosphorus deficient soil, that is the main reason for deficiency of the phosphorus in the diet. Actually, the soils from all over the world, they are deficient in the phosphorus, and the as far as Indian soils are concerned, they are also deficient in the phosphorus. And therefore, phosphorus deficiency is a soil-borne deficiency. Then exclusive feeding of hay, kadbi, and straws. The kadbi, straw, or hay from any area, even if it is from the area having a sufficient soil phosphorus, they are naturally deficient. So hay, kadbi, and straws are naturally deficient, and therefore, the exclusive feeding of hay, kadbi, and straws leads to phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria. Drought conditions usually precipitate the phosphorus deficiency. Impaired absorption of phosphorus from the gut, wide calcium phosphorus ratio, that is responsible for reduced absorption of phosphorus. Already I have told that calcium phosphorus ratio is very wide in dry roughages, even green roughages, and the forages grown on phosphorus deficient soil, they are having naturally a very wide calcium phosphorus ratio. The phosphorus requirement is increased to the great extent during the lactation as well as advanced pregnancy. Through every kg of milk, nearly 1 gram of phosphorus is being drained. If a cow is producing 10 liters of milk, means she is losing 10 grams of phosphorus through every kg of the milk. And as far as the serum phosphorus pool is concerned, the total serum phosphorus in a cow weighing 400 kg is around only 2 grams. So such a huge amount of phosphorus is being drained through the milk. And that is the reason for a negative phosphorus balance. The analysis of soil from our area showed very low phosphate and high level of calcium. Analysis of feed and fodder samples from a disease-prone area showed typically very high calcium, 1.4, 1.36, 2.2. This is very high levels of calcium were found. The calcium requirement of animal, lactating animal, is 0.4 to 0.6%. And the calcium present in the diet was around 1.4 to 2.2%. The phosphorus requirement for dairy animals, milch animal, is around 0.2 to 0.3%. And the phosphorus contained of the different forages was very low. In kadbi, it was 0.07. Dry grass, it was 0.078. And in concentrate, it was found to be optimal. The typical clinical signs of phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria, they included the normal temperature, straining during defecation, and passage of coffee colored urine. Mucous membranes were invariably pale or maybe palictic. So here you can see the animal is passing coffee colored urine, mucous membranes are pale, animal is showing typical straining while defecation and the coffee colored urine. On PM examination, the urine was found to be coffee colored. In a gallbladder, kidneys were blackish due to hemoglobinuria. So the diagnosis of the phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria can be very well made based on the history, can be made based on the history of advanced pregnancy early lactation. So advanced pregnancy or early lactation, these are the predisposing factors. Then exclusive feeding of the dry enough ages. Season, that should be considered, particularly dry season when the greens are not available. The three typical signs, that is a light or dark coffee colored urine, pale mucous membranes, and passage of testy feces with straining. Hematological examination usually shows low HBPCV and TNC values. Low serum inorganic phosphorus or hypophosphatemia is a characteristic, you can see the biochemical feature. And on centrifugation, the hemoglobin urea is formed. Under field conditions, the phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria can be very well confirmed by judging response to the phosphorus treatment. The phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria needs to be differentiated from the diseases characterized by hematuria and the hemoglobinuria. So under field conditions, we are likely to get both types of the cases, and they need a differential diagnosis. The first step in the differential diagnosis is observation. So in hematuria, urine appears red and opaque, whereas in hemoglobinuria, the urine color is usually brown or coffee colored. On centrifugation in hematuria, usually the RBCs, they will settle at the bottom, whereas in the hemoglobinuria, the sediment is somewhat greenish and the urine will be uniformly red. So indirectly, hemoglobinuria can be identified if we are unable to collect the urine sample by centrifugation of the blood. So on centrifugation, in case of the hematuria, the plasma will appear normal to yellowish, depending upon the species. Whereas in case of hemoglobinuria, plasma is reddish. So these are the conditions which are characterized by hemoglobinuria in case of the cattle and buffaloes. These are the conditions which are characterized by hematuria in case of cattle and buffaloes. Whenever animal is passing red urine, the main disease or the major disease which needs to be considered in the differential diagnosis is a babesiosis. So in babesiosis, usually there is history of tick infestation. Cattle, they are more susceptible than buffaloes. Usually cattle, I have seen that 10 times they are more susceptible than buffalo. Then coffee colored urine is accompanied by fever and anorexia is usually severe. The blood smear examination reveals babesia, and there is a good response to diaminazine or imidacarb treatment. PPH cases, they doesn't give response to the diaminazine. So in my opinion, three factors should be considered in the differential diagnosis. Number one is a species factor. Buffaloes are susceptible to hemoglobinuria. Cattle, they are susceptible to babesiosis. Second factor, fever is absent in hemoglobinuria. Fever is present in babesia. And third, babesiosis cases, they give good response to diaminazine, whereas the hemoglobinuric animals, they doesn't give response to. Next disease which needs to differential diagnosis, that is leptospirosis. It is found in certain areas. It affects the animals of all age groups. In young animals or young cows, usually it is characterized by hemoglobinuria, whereas in adult animals, usually it is characterized by jaundice. It is also accompanied by, it is also characterized by abortion in advanced pregnant animals. The cases of Leptospira, they are found in certain areas. So it is endemic in certain areas, particularly in the southern states, Konkan areas. The next disease which needs differential diagnosis, that is the bacillary hemoglobinuria, which has not so far been reported from our country. The it needs differential diagnosis from water intoxication. But water intoxication occurs only in cows. It doesn't occur in adult animals. It doesn't occur in adult animals. So this is a typical differentiating feature. And water intoxication occurs in 4 to 8 month old cows, which are drinking large amount of water. And such type of the cases can be very well managed by reducing the water intake or by giving water at frequent intervals. We have also recorded and seen cases of onion poisoning in animals. So onion poisoning can occur in adult as well as young animals. And onion poisoning is characterized by signs very similar to that of hemoglobinuria. Body temperature is usually subnormal, and there is a hemoglobinuria or red urine, and animal passes feces with a straining. Here we can make differential diagnosis based on feeding history. So you will get history of feeding of onion leaves or whole onions. Rarely in a snake bite cases, the hemoglobinuria or hematuria may occur. I have experience of managing more than 500 cases of snake bite in animals, and I have come across with few rare cases of hemoglobinuria due to snake bite as well as hematuria due to snake bite. But that is very rare, and these cases, they show typical, you can see the ascending swelling over limb or asymmetrical type of swelling over the face. Then hematuria sometimes occur in case of cattle and buffaloes. It is rare that way in the females. It is more common in bullocks, and the main cause of hematuria in bullock, that is urinary calculi. In case of hematuria due to nephritis, inform is uniformly red and it is throughout urination. In case of cystitis, usually the hematuria or red urine is seen at the end of micturition, whereas in urethritis, the red urine is seen at the beginning of urination. Again, hematuria may occur because of uterine bleeding or vaginal bleeding. Such rare cases may be observed. So when the blood is present in the vagina, that can come along with the urine, and it appears like a hematuria. Again, I have seen a rare case of even anthrax, a clinical case of anthrax, which was showing hematuria. Even I have seen a case of black water, which passed red urine. And even in one of the cases, on postmortem examination, I could see the hematuria or presence of red-colored urine in the bladder. Already I have told about the snake bite. Snake bite may either cause hemoglobinuria or hematuria, but that's very rare. Now, how to treat the cases of phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria or PPH in a cows? See, the phosphorus supplementation is required. Hypophosphatemia is the biochemical defect, and therefore we'll have to give phosphorus to correct the hypophosphatemia. That is the rational treatment. Sodium acid phosphate was being used for years together for the management of PPH cases. The dose is 60 to 80 gram by intravenous route as a 20% solution. Minimum 2, maximum 4 doses. This is being inorganic phosphorus preparation, restores the phosphorus level. But rapid administration of phosphorus, the sodium acid phosphate, may lead to shivering, dyspnea, collapse, and even death inside the tanks. But this is very rare. This can be very well prevented by slow administration of sodium acid phosphate. I have never come across with any case of adverse reaction to sodium acid phosphate, because we used to give sodium acid phosphate by intravenous route very slowly. alternative to this sodium acid phosphate preparation is a buffered phosphorus preparation. Now it is available in the market for the last 10 years. This is a buffered phosphorus preparation. It contains a sodium dihydrogen phosphate as well as disodium hydrogen phosphate, and its pH is adjusted to the blood. This is the advantage, and therefore the adverse reactions doesn't occur. So usually we recommend this particular preparation for the management of hemoglobinuria under the fetal condition. The dose is 50 ml intravenously daily for 2 to 4 days. In case of very high yielding and heavyweight buffaloes, we can give 100 ml of buffered phosphorus preparation on day first. But this dose is sufficient, and maximum number of doses required are 4. Organic phosphorus preparations can be used as alternative, but these preparations, although they are safe, they doesn't restore the serum inorganic phosphorus level, and therefore, scientifically speaking, we should not use this organic phosphorus preparation. But if the inorganic is not available, in that case it should be used. Some workers have also used antioxidant type of preparation, because hypophosphatemia causes oxidative stress on RBCs, and that is responsible for Hinge body hemolytic anemia. So giving antioxidant is a rational treatment, and we can get good results with antioxidants also. But antioxidants, they give relief from oxidative stress, but they doesn't correct the phosphorus level, and therefore I don't recommend antioxidants alone. If you want to use it, you can use it along with this sodium acid phosphate preparation. Supportive treatment is equally important. Just giving sodium acid phosphate is not sufficient. We'll have to give supportive treatment for a complete recovery. So injection dextrose is to be given for 5 days, near 3 to 5 days. 20% hypertonic solution, we can give 1 to 1.5 liter slowly. Here, the dextrose will not provide only energy to the animal, anorectic animal. But dextrose is very important for utilization of phosphorus. Phosphorus and dextrose, they are interdependent. They increase the utilization of each other. And therefore, dextrose is very much helpful. B-complex preparations and iron preparations, they are recommended for correction of anemia. Injectable preparations can be very well given for you can say the 5 to 6 days, and we can continue the iron preparations by oral route. Generally, I recommend oral administration of iron preparations, because most of the iron preparations, they are irritant and they are causing local swelling. So you can use, and oral preparations are highly effective, so you can use any oral preparation like a sarcopherol wet for the treatment of anemia, for correction of anemia. But it needs to be continued for minimum 20 days. In some cases, we'll have to continue it for 30 days. Mineral mixture is to be advised even after correction of phosphorus level by giving sodium acid phosphate on a regular basis. That should be our regular practice. In very severe cases where the hemoglobin has gone down to maybe a 2.2, 2.4 gram, blood transfusion is a lifesaver. And therefore, we can try blood transfusion in cases having a severe anemia. Here you can see some pictures, the urine sample before and after treatment, the pale mucous membrane before and 21 days after treatment. We are also practicing blood transfusion in our clinic. We are giving to the animals suffering from hemoglobinuria, and we have made it a very simple practice. Our farm animals, they are the live donors, and we are collecting the blood from our farm animals, and we are giving it to the cases which are being presented in our clinics. The one more disease which I would like to discuss, because this is a neglected disease and nobody bothers for this disease, that is osteomalacia. This is a metabolic bone disorder. This is a metabolic bone disorder, and osteomalacia means softening of the bones. In countries abroad, it is called as the peg leg, creeps, milk leg, milk lameness, adult rickets. These are the terminologies particularly used in countries abroad that for cows. In India, in Punjab and Haryana, this particular disease is called as the rheumatism-like syndrome, are here in our Maharashtra, it is called as Urmuri. This particular disease is characterized by difficulty in moving, walking, and difficulty in getting up. This is again a disease of hiding cows and buffaloes. This disease is economically important, characterized by loss of milk production for a long period. Then fertility is certainly reduced. Recovery period is very long, and this particular disease is you see the accompanied results of our study at Vasudhir indicate incidence around 1.67%. We have recorded maximum number of cases during the summer. You can see the here is we have recorded cases during monsoon, but that too during early monsoon when the greens were not available. The disease was found to be more common in lactating animals. 95% of the cases were in the lactating animals. Very few cases in the pregnant animals. The disease was found to be more common in animals in the late stage of lactation. During early lactation, few cases were recorded. Again, the disease was found to be more common in yielding animals. Again, we have seen a correlation between the disease and the feeding pattern. Again, this disease is related to the exclusive feeding of the dry fodder. So 92% of the cases, they were getting only dry fodder. They were getting only dry fodder with a meager quantity of the concentrate. You all know that diastomalacia in all animal species is caused by either deficiency of calcium or vitamin D or deficiency of the phosphorus. These are the three important causes. In animals also, the cases of osteomalacia, they are sometimes diagnosed and previously they were being treated with calcium preparations in our area. Considering hypocalcemia as a cause of osteomalacia. But our study revealed that osteomalacia is primarily due to exclusive feeding of fodder containing significantly low levels of the phosphorus. The phosphorus level was less than 0.1%. That means the phosphorus level is not sufficient to meet even the maintenance requirement of our animals. The second cause we could find that is high levels of calcium, 1.33% calcium in the diet, which is very high, which is nearly three times, you can say, more than the calcium required. The calcium phosphorus ratio, average calcium phosphorus ratio found was 20 is to 1. Normal, you all know that 2 is to 1. So it was 20 times more. So this is the pathogenesis which we could find: high calcium diet, low phosphorus in the forage, and high milk yield. The typical signs which we have recorded in the cases, we have divided those signs in the three different stages. For the first time, we have categorized this disease into three stages. First stage is characterized by just a loss of body condition. We see the signs of only loss of body condition, progressive loss of body weight with nearly normal milk yield, reduced fertility, somewhat disinclination to move. During the second stage, the animal starts showing the signs of lameness, that is a shifting lameness. You can see there is shifting lameness, lameness shift from one leg to another leg. Then third stage is very typical. During this stage, the stiff gait is marked, arching of back is also marked. So here you can see that the lameness is there, reluctance to move is there, arching of back is there. Here there is again a reluctance to move and abduction is there. Here, this is in my opinion very typical sign, and I used to diagnose the cases of osteomalacia just by asking the animal owner about the posture of the animal. The animals, they face difficulty while getting up. Usually they keep on knee for a long time. Buffaloes, they get up normally slowly, but usually in one jerk. They keep on knee and then they get up. But most of the affected buffaloes, they keep on knee for a long time. I have seen sometimes the buffaloes, they remained on a knee for nearly 5 minutes. I have seen one buffalo which was just moving on a knee. It was unable to get up. So depending upon the severity, we can see the difficulty in getting up. That animal keeps on a knee for a long time while getting up. We call it as a kneeling. Animal shows tendency to lie down. And in extreme cases, if the case is not treated, some animals may recover. This is the rare case which I have seen, which recovered, but showed the permanent deformity, bone deformity. Here you can see the arched back posture. Here you can see the kneeling on a carpal joint. Here you can see the abduction of the elbows with arched back. We have seen this particular disease in even our local buffaloes, which are yielding around 4 to 6 liters of milk. The hematological examination revealed usually CBC is normal. Biochemical examination usually reveals severe hypophosphatemia, mild hypocalcemia, and high levels of serum alkaline phosphatase. The X-ray examination proved the osteolytic changes. So under field conditions, how can we diagnose the osteomalacia? Based on history of high milk yield and exclusive feeding of dry roughages, giving meager quantity or very small quantity of concentrate during dry season. When greens are abundant, usually cases, they doesn't occur. The clinical signs, they include typical clinical signs. The course is very longer. Usually it takes 15 days to 1 month to develop the signs. So in the beginning, emaciation followed by disinclination to move, lameness, stiff gait, arching of back, and then difficulty while getting up. So this is a typical pattern of the signs. On blood examination, serum biochemical examination, severe hypophosphatemia is a characteristic. Radiographic, in my opinion, radiographic examination will help you in ruling out the possibility of foreign body syndrome. And good response to the phosphorus supplement under the field condition is helping us in confirmative diagnosis. This disease needs to be differentiated from the most common disease which is being occurring under the field condition, that is the traumatic reticuloperitonitis. So before, we did the research on osteomalacia. The cases showing signs of osteomalacia were also operated for remnantectomy, and with no evidence of foreign body. So TRP needs to be differentiated, but in TRP usually arching of the back is in the lumbar region, whereas in case of osteomalacia, arching of back is found at the wither region. That is the most characteristic feature. In TRP, appetite is nearly upset. Liver may be present, tympani may be present. Whereas in osteomalacia, see, usually appetite is nearly normal. Milk yield is nearly normal during first and second stage. And there is no tympani. And good response to the phosphorus supplementation. Cases of sprain, usually acute, and appetite and body temperature, they are normal and they will give very good response to our analgesics. Arthritis, usually there is a swelling of the joints. Chronic chlorosis, bones are involved, but usually there is one difference between osteomalacia and this particular chlorosis. In chlorosis, tooth abnormalities are seen, as well as the joints are swollen. Whereas in case of osteomalacia, joints are not swollen. In initial stage, this disease needs to be differentiated from ketosis. The treatment is very simple. Once diagnosis is made, I'm of the opinion that the cases can be treated very easily. Every year, I used to treat more than 200 to 300 cases telephonically or on WhatsApp also. So treatment is so simple. We have tried several drugs. We have tried organic phosphorus, injectable organic phosphorus preparations, injectable type of inorganic phosphorus preparations, oral type of the preparations at different dose rates. And we have arrived at the conclusion that mineral mixture at the rate of 20 gram per 100 kg. So if buffalo is weighing around 100 kg, she needs 100 gram of mineral mixture. At least 100 gram of mineral mixture should be given on a regular basis to an adult animal. Maybe in a 2 divided doses, 50 gram in the morning, 50 gram in the evening. The alternative to this is a sodium acid phosphate. So minimum 30 gram, maximum 60 gram. So generally we are giving 20 gram per 100 kg body weight. And this treatment needs to be continued for 30 days. 1 month treatment is required for getting good results and rapid initial improvement. We can go for an injectable type of preparations, maybe for first 3 days. So we can give 3 injections of any buffer phosphorus preparation or sodium acid phosphate injectable preparation, followed by any mineral mixture or sodium acid phosphate. In my opinion, mineral mixtures in high doses, they are better. Because whenever there is a deficiency of phosphorus, usually there are concurrent deficiencies of cobalt that are also likely to develop. And so it is better to go for a mineral mixture. Just you can see the pictures, how drastic improvement we can see after just mineral supplementation in affected buffaloes. Buffalo before and after treatment. Here again, you can see the buffalo nearly 2 months after after treatment. Same buffalo before and after treatment. Again, you can see the drastic improvement in the body condition and the body weight. But usually 1 month is required for a recovery. 1 month is required. And owner as well as doctor has to show the patients, lot of patients. The first sign of improvement which I noticed, that is improvement in appetite and water intake, and animal becomes alert and active within 3 to 4 days. Usually the skin appears, skin becomes shining within 8 days, and there is some improvement in the gait. But usually it takes 15 to 20 days for a good recovery. And for a complete recovery, 1 month is required. And doctor definitely and the farmer has to wait for minimum 15 days for observing the signs of recovery. This phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria as well as phosphorus deficiency osteomalacia can be very well prevented. Actually, these are the diseases of high-yielding animals, high-yielding buffaloes primarily, and even these diseases can occur in a high-yielding crossbred cows too. But I have seen that the buffaloes, they are nearly 10 times more susceptible than cows for osteomalacia as well as for phosphorus deficiency hemoglobinuria. Another thing which I have seen, buffaloes, in case of the buffaloes, the osteomalacia is always severe. And in buffaloes, in osteomalacia, there is difficulty while getting up. So mineral mixture is to be given on a regular basis. It is to be given on a regular basis to the milch animals. These are the requirement. Generally, the maintenance requirement is 13 gram for an average animal weighing 400 kg. So regular mineral supplementation and provision of concentrate will definitely help in prevention of these diseases. I have monitored so many cases for, you see, 2-3 lactations, and I have the farmers who were giving mineral mixture on a regular basis, they didn't encounter the recurrence of osteomalacia as well as PPH in their buffaloes. So this is all about my presentation, because it was a very big topic, and therefore it took nearly 1.5 hours. Whatever experience that I have shared with all of you, if you have any queries, yes, we'll discuss. You can also share. You can add to my knowledge also. So thank you all.
Thank you very much, sir. We'll have some questions are there, sir. I will display that question.
Okay.
5 to 10 questions we'll take and then we'll follow.
Okay.
Dr. Naresh, you are sharing?
But I'm unable to see this.
I'll share, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes.
So there are so many questions as such. But the first question that the what type of diet? Right.
To be fed in a dry period.
Yes, sir.
To control excessive calcium.
Calcium injection. Actually, Dr. Samir has asked.
Dry roughages, what we have seen that the dry roughages, they are very rich in calcium. Concentrates, they are optimum, poor to optimum in calcium. It is very difficult to provide optimum amount of calcium through any type of diet during advanced pregnancy. Usually, excess of calcium through the diet is the biggest problem. It is the biggest problem. Wherever the animals are exclusively maintained on the dry fodder. If dry fodder along with the concentrate, if it is given, then definitely the ratio can be narrowed down and even the calcium content of the diet can be reduced. So there are naturally controlled, and therefore I have recommended and we are recommending that dietary cation and anion balance is to be manipulated during last maybe 1 or 2 weeks of advanced pregnancy, number one. Number two, vitamin D is the best prophylactic measure which can help us in keeping bone metabolism active. Second, intravenous calcium infusion will be helpful in Downer cow or chronic milk fever case. What is the prognosis? See, in a chronic milk fever case or a recurrent cases of milk fever, already we have discussed this point. Calcium hypocalcemia is many times accompanied by hypomagnesemia and hypophosphatemia, and that may sometimes leads to recurrence of the milk fever. So we have to take care of hypophosphatemia and hypomagnesemia by administering compound type of the preparation instead of administering calcium repeatedly. Repeated administration of calcium is to be avoided. When there is a recurrence, definitely we'll have to take a review of our diagnosis, we'll have to reevaluate our case, and accordingly we'll have to change the line of treatment. For prevention of recurrence, the vitamin D or dicationic calcium with vitamin D we can give. Yes. So the genetic predisposition, as far as all these metabolic diseases are concerned, genetic predisposition is there, and therefore the animal which suffer from milk fever, ketosis, or maybe a PPH during one lactation is likely to suffer during next lactation. But is very important, if we make proper changes in the diet, feeding pattern, and if we adopt proper control measures, then surely we can prevent the the recurrence of the milk fever or occurrence of the milk fever in the subsequent lactation. I have shared my personal experience as far as PPH and osteomalacia is concerned. In Downer cow syndrome, intravenous calcium infusion is not responding. Sometimes what may be the reason? Because you see, the calcium sometimes administration will correct the hypocalcemia, but there are some other causes which are responsible for persistence of the Downer cow syndrome. Apart from persistent hypocalcemia, hypophosphatemia has also been considered as one of the causes of Downer cow syndrome. So give phosphorus preparations. Hypomagnesemia may sometimes lead to persistence of the Downer cow syndrome or occurrence of the Downer cow syndrome. So there magnesium treatment is required. Then damage to the muscles, recumbency leading to nervous, you can say the neuronal damage, muscle damage may also lead to persistence of the recumbency. We'll have to go for even potassium-like preparations maybe our oral preparations, even parenterally also, carefully, we can give potassium chloride solutions in affected animals. So Downer cow syndrome is always multifactorial and it is a complicated one. Is it feasible? Yes, I have responded to that question. Next question is, what is the treatment protocol for recurrent cases of hypocalcemia? It's a very good question. I have actually replied to this question in my presentation. For recurrent cases of hypocalcemia, just few days back I came across with a case which showed recurrent milk fever on 4 to 5 occasions. So in recurrent cases of hypocalcemia, number one, give calcium in full dose on a day one. If there is a recurrence, again give calcium, but followed by calcium, give one bottle of calcium phosphorus magnesium containing preparation. That is Mifex-like preparation. This is another thing. Even my teacher, Professor Buxing, used to tell me that one bottle of calcium and one bottle of, compound type of calcium preparation is beneficial in preventing the recurrence of the milk fever cases. Second recommendation, give a dichotonic calcium preparations like maybe a Calg-12 or Intercalpe, whatever may be, calcium plus vitamin D3 preparation, maybe 3 injections at 2 days interval. That will help in maintaining the calcium level in the blood, number one. That will also provide the vitamin D, which is required for, you see, the mobilization of calcium from the bone, increasing the absorption from the intestine. So in my opinion, this treatment protocol comprising dichotonic calcium, vitamin D, and a one compound solution will definitely help in a complete recovery from the cases of hypocalcemia. Next, please.
Sir, actually, there is one question in Marathi as such. I'll just tell you that question. That sir, gai madhe na basne kiwa satat ube rahane sarke problems dita. TRP nasto, tar to osteomalacia asu shakto kay.
त्यांच्यामध्ये लक्षणं काय होते
गायमध्ये सतत न बसणे सतत उभे राहणे
हो
यासारखे प्रॉब्लेम्स दिसतात पण त्यावेळेस एक्सरे केल्यानंतर टीआरपी नसतो किंवा ट्रोमॅटो रेटिक्युलर पेरिकार्डायटिस सारखे काही लक्षणं दिसत नाही तर तो ऑस्टोमलेशिया असू शकतो का
खाणंपिणं कसं असतं त्यांच्यामध्ये चारा खाणे आणि पाणी पिणं कसं असतं
डॉक्टर यू कॅन आन्सर डॉक्टर
प्रोडक्शन लेवल ऑल्सो मेंटेन एट 80-90% दे रेजिस्ट टू सीट
राइट आई गॉट सो आई गॉट अ वेरी करेक्ट हिस्ट्री
जॉइंट पेन
In my opinion, these are the cases of mineral deficiency. Maybe see the osteomalacia, not exhibiting the typical second or third stage, which is characterized by the arching of the back. Whether you have seen such type of the cases in a crossbred cow?
Yes, sir. They are in crossbred cows, and we are getting such cases. Maybe 5 or 6 cases in a year by every vet. I mean, regardless of the area and dry fodder also means in green fodder also.
Very high yielding animals.
Yeah.
See, such type of the cases should be managed with the mineral mixture. Give extra amount of phosphorus to these animals for at least 1 month. Apart from the mineral mixture, we can give the phosphorus preparation to these animals. Next question.
See, Naresh, move on to next question, please. Naresh.
Yes, sir. There is one question that is the isoflurane. Can we give it in the ketosis?
Yes, it can be used. You see, isoproprednone can also be used. Next, isoproprednone can be used, but steroids should be used in a step two treatment. I am of the opinion that we should manage the cases of ketosis with dextrose, hypertonic dextrose, and B complex, accompanied by regular feeding of mineral mixture and correction of the diet. The dietary correction is very important. Diet correction is very important. Steroids should be avoided as far as possible, because you all know that after giving steroids, usually there is a drop in milk yield, and that creates a somewhat adverse or piquant situation for us. But those cases which are not responding to glucose alone, yes, you can go for a steroid, one or two doses of steroid. Is giving cooked grain daily to cow, is it beneficial? I have seen this type of practice in one goshala. Dr. Gujarati, yes. Cooked grain, I have come across with these things. In the cooked grains, when they are given to the animal, usually the propionate formation is more. And know that when propionate formation is more, the propionate is a glucose precursor, and therefore certainly it will help in preventing the ketosis. Then how to do Rothera's test? It's a very good question. For Rothera's test, we need sodium nitroprusside and ammonium chloride or ammonium sulfate. That is what required. So here, in a test tube, you will have to take 1 ml of urine, add very small crystal of sodium nitroprusside, very small crystal. It should give very light color to the urine. That is the second step. Third, add ammonium chloride, or ammonium sulfate. Saturate it, add till that doesn't get dissolved. So saturation is required. And then pour 1 ml of urine by the side of test tube. Don't pour it directly into the urine. Pour it by the side of the test tube so that it should form a layer over the solution. Appearance of you can see the permanganate color at the junction is a characteristic of Rothera's test. This test is also, it gives sometimes a false positive and false negative reaction, but overall, it's a very good bedside test, and it can be used on a farm for prevention and control of this ketosis. Then please comment on treatment of Downworth syndrome using potassium chloride. Yes, potassium chloride can be given by oral route as well as parenteral route in cases of Downworth cow syndrome. Particularly the cases which are showing recumbency during summer season, maybe 2 months after parturition, show hypocalcemia as well as hypokalemia. That is our observation. And the use of preparations containing potassium help in getting recovery. How to... It's not visible. This question number 14.
Yes, sir. How to identify the calcium deficiency, whether it is due to the high content of potassium or anything else?
Identify the basic cause of calcium,
cause of the calcium deficiency.
Deficiency of high content of potassium or anything else, Dr. So it is rather difficult, but during my discussion and presentation, I shared that our soils are rich in potassium. The forage analysis which have been carried out by different researchers indicated high levels of potassium, but low levels of sodium in the forage. So high levels of potassium in the diet reduces the absorption of calcium from the gut. And therefore, the availability of the calcium, although it is present in, large amount in the dry fodder, the availability of the calcium from the dry fodder may be less because of excess of potassium in the diet.
Thank you very much, sir. Sir, what we'll do, whatever the question they are typing, we'll compile it and we'll answer and we'll send it to that, sir.
Okay.
Because some of the participating are leaving. So we'll conclude, sir.
I will answer this question number 6. Okay, sir. Christine, that last already I have told about calcium supplementation, the diet. What is the dose of ASV in a snake bite? So the dose actually is it is variable. It varies from case to case. But we have standardized the treatment protocol for snake bite in our clinic based on our vast experience. And I am of the opinion that in large buffaloes, adult buffaloes, as well as adult cows or bullocks, minimum 2 vials of anti-snake venom should be given and maximum 4 vials are required. And the dose is to be increased depending upon the blood clotting time, platelet count, and the bleeding. If bleeding continues after 6 hours, you can go for a third. Initially, give 2 vials. If bleeding continues, if you think that the case is severe, platelet count is very low, or blood clotting time is very high, you can go for a third vial. If required, you can go for a fourth vial. Generally, 4 vials, they are sufficient. They are sufficient. And we have treated nearly 75 to 80% cases with only 2 vials. Having even platelet count less than like that's a very big topic. That's a very interesting topic. We can discuss even for 1 hour. That's a very any other question to be answered or
there are the questions, but we'll compile it and we'll get back to you, sir.
Okay.
Regarding the same.
Okay, doctor. Thank you, sir. I will give the vote of thanks. Then we will formally close the meeting, sir. Okay. Okay. Can you stop the sharing, please?
Yeah.
Sir, on the behalf of all the participants and from the Alembic Pharmaceuticals, myself, Dr. Santosh Shinde, express my gratitude to Dr. Bikani, sir, for such an informative presentation on production diseases. Sir, your presentation will definitely help the field veterinarian, especially the diagnosis and treatment of the production diseases, but I think especially the differential diagnosis which you told today, sir. Apart from that, sir, we hope that in future also we will take benefit of such interesting and useful session that will upgrade our knowledge, hence we can serve the society. I will also like to thank Anurag Bikane, the son of Dr. Bikane, for his help to make this webinar successful. Last but not least, I will thank to the all the participating veterinarian for the participating and making the webinar successful. I thank you very. Thank you again to Dr. Bikane sir and all the participating veterinarian. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.